This is the day you've been waiting for. The sun is shining, the birds are singing, and you know just what you want to do.
All you want to do is ride around Saturday.
Ride, Saturday, ride.
You know, it is not very often that one gets to meet a living legend, an icon. Hi, everybody. Rick Lamb here for The Horse Show. I know that sounds kind of highfalutin. Those are pretty strong words, but I kind of feel they're appropriate today. I'm kind of reminiscing a little bit about a gentleman that I met back in 2001, and he certainly was then and is today an icon. He is the quintessential painter of quarter horse portraits. His name is Orren Mixer, and if you've seen the painting of the quarter horse that is used so often by the AQHA, kind of out in a field, and it's just nicely muscled, just a beautiful horse. That is an Orren Mixer painting. And he's going to talk a little bit about painting that today. If you've seen the paint horse painting that they use is kind of symbolic of their breed that has both a Tobiano and an Overo paint horse out in a field, that again, Orren Mixer's work. If you've seen the cover of any of the Legends books that Western Horseman has put out, again, Orren Mixer's work. And I was certainly familiar with him and a big admirer of his talent when I met him back in 2001 at the AQHA World Show. He had a booth set up in the trade area, and it was kind of a slow afternoon. I was wandering around, and there he happened to be, and I was kind of dumbstruck that he was out there and I could actually talk to him. So we got to chatting, and I realized I had a golden opportunity to do an interview with him, and I virtually always have my recording equipment with me. So I said, hey, would you like to do something on my radio show with me? And he graciously agreed, and he told some great stories, and we laughed, and he signed that picture of the quarter horse that is so popular for me. And it just left me with such a positive feeling. I aired that interview on the radio in 2001, again in 2002, and it's been sitting in the archives ever since. And I think it's particularly appropriate to bring it out today, this week, for you to enjoy. Because you see, my friend's Orren Mixer passed away last weekend at the age of 87. So this is my tribute to him. May he rest in peace. Towards the end of the program today, Dr. Jennifer MacLeay is going to join us. She's an assistant professor at Colorado State University and a doctor of veterinary medicine. She's written a book called Smart Horse, Training Your Horse with the Science of Natural Horsemanship. And she's going to kind of focus on the science behind this whole business of training horses. This is something I talk about quite often when I do lectures, is that this whole business, the underlying principles of natural horsemanship, making right things easy and wrong things difficult, really nothing more than what B.F. Skinner called operant conditioning. You reward behaviors you want to see repeated, and you punish or discourage behaviors you don't want to see repeated. This is science. This is as straightforward as it gets. It's the key to all animal training. It's the key to training children, for that matter, or employees, or anything. So we're going to talk about that today with Dr. Jennifer MacLeay. Now, I want to remind you about my website, thehorseshow.com, because we update it every single week. I've got a blog now. I try and write something on that each week. And, of course, where I'm going to be, all of my appearances, you'll find them there. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show, and we'll be back. Stay with us.
EPM is a devastating neurologic disease that can strike anytime, anywhere. Be prepared with Protozil, the only FDA-approved top-dress EPM treatment. These alfalfa-based pellets are proven to rapidly reach therapeutic levels and are a less stressful option for you and your horse than a paste. For a limited time only, Merck Animal Health is offering a $50 Protozil rebate with proof of purchase from your veterinarian. To download the rebate, visit Protozil.com. That's Protazil.com. See website for complete product safety information.
Make watering your horses automatic and absolutely safe with the Bar A horse drinker. It's non-electric, and the bowl empties after every drink. That keeps the water warmer in winter and cooler in summer. Plus, you avoid breeding mosquitoes or algae. Right now, save 10% on the Bar A horse drinker when you mention Rick Lamb. 10%. Call 800-451-2230 or visit horsedrinker.com. The Bar A horse drinker. 800-451-2230 or horsedrinker.com.
Every month, there's hands-on advice from the pros in Horse and Rider, the how-to magazine for Western riding. Call now and get 2 years for the price of one, just $24. 1-800-829-3340.
As you can imagine, I get inundated with horse magazines and books every single month. I always make time to read Horse and Rider. It is the how-to magazine for Western riding. Wouldn't do without it. Call 1-800-829-3340 and say Rick Lamb sent you.
Red Brand Fence welcomes you to visit our new online store called redbrandstore.com. There you can purchase Red Brand Fence, installation tools, and a wide selection of Red Brand clothing and accessories. Ordering is easy, and items are shipped directly to your home, including fence. There's also special offers and seasonal promotions. And for a limited time, listeners of The Horse Show can receive 10% off your first order of fence, clothing, or tools. To receive your discount, go to redbrandstore.com and enter promo code HORSESHOW10.
For 128 years, ADM Alliance Nutrition has been doing what's right for the horse. It was ADM who cut back on starch and sugar, ADM who balanced vitamins and minerals, and ADM who put forage first in horse nutrition. Today, you can still trust ADM for the information and products you need. Learn more about equine nutrition and ADM's premium products at growstrong.com. That's growstrong.com. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse.
Imagine this, your stirrup drops 3 inches with the push of a button and locks back in place with the lift of your toe. That, my friends, is the legendary Easy Up Stirrup Extender, and it makes a huge difference in mounting your horse. Learn all about it at easyupstirrup.com, and while you're there, check out the Easy Up Stirrup Swivel. It takes the stress off your knees while riding. Easy Up Stirrup Extenders and Stirrup Swivels are available for English and Western saddles, and you can order them online at easyupstirrup.com. Come on, get out and ride again.
Now, back to the Horse Show with Rick Lamb.
Here at the AQHA World Show, you see a lot of legendary horses and horsemen, but you also can this year see a gentleman who is the painter of the Legend series for a Western Horseman magazine. He is a legend in his own right, and his name is Orren Mixer, and I just happen to be standing right here with him. And we're going to talk a little bit about his life, his career, his art. Orren, welcome.
Good to talk to you.
I got to ask you something here, first of all, about this classic picture of the quarter horse, which he's busy autographing for me right now. I've heard some discussion about what horse you were painting when you did that. And some people said it was Wimpy. Some people said it was this and that horse. What horse was it?
I've painted for 7 organizations, and I have never used a certain horse for any of my paintings. But at that time, I was painting probably 6 different horses. And about 3 of those people always told people that I was using their horse for a model. Well, I might have used part of their horse, but this is an Orren Mixer creation. And I didn't use any certain horse for the complete horse.
So that is totally out of your own mind what you felt the ideal quarter horse should be.
That's right. I thought he was a little bit better than the regular bulldog horse that they started with. And you drop down and he's not a... He don't have the looks of a thoroughbred. He's right between the thoroughbred and the bulldog. The association started out with a bulldog, and I think they made the mistake by saying that the bulldog was a quarter horse and said he could outrun any horse for a quarter of a mile. Well, there's a lot of horse people proved that wrong, and that's the reason I created this horse. He's a little bit, got a little more speed in him than a bulldog would have, but yet he don't look like a thoroughbred.
He's got a little bit more height to him. He's not quite as heavily muscled. A little bit longer neck. Not the big, super prominent jaw of a bulldog. It is a beautiful, beautiful painting. This being the classic quarter horse painting, there's also a classic paint horse painting that shows both a Tobiano and an Overo. I have a feeling that you did that one as well.
Yes, sir. I did that. And I try to do what they tell me to do. And I was about finished with it, and somebody said, well, you got to have a Roadrunner in there. And somebody else said, well, you got to have a windmill back there. And I thought, well, if I'm going to have the Roadrunners, I painted a coyote back there in the bushes watching the Roadrunner. And since then, well, quite a few of these pictures, people started looking for little animals in my pictures. And I think I was looking one the other day, had 4 deer in it. I forgot about that.
Now, let me ask you something about, we're fortunate enough to be standing here in front of an original Orren Mixer. I would say it's probably about 2 feet by 2.5 feet, something like that. And because it's a composite, the horses themselves are no larger than maybe 6 inches. That is not the typical size that you paint horses, correct?
No, I've painted 3 paintings like this. One of B.F. Phillips, that had cutting, racing, and show horse. And then I painted one for Gordon Brown of Little Rock, Arkansas. I had a head picture of him with some of his prize horses. He mostly had halter horses, and they were the best. And he also had one that was a great rope horse. I had it in there. But I really don't do those things, but these people were friends of mine and always good to me. And I felt like that it wouldn't hurt for them to have a picture like that.
Well, let me ask you, a typical painting of a horse, if there is such a thing, I know that everyone's a little bit different. Do you start with a big canvas and then they get kind of reduced to the size that we finally see them, for instance, on the cover of a book or whatever?
Most of my pictures are around 30 by 40 on the average. Some bigger and some a little bit smaller. I made a picture of a family in Mexico City that, golly, that had the man and his wife and a little boy. The man was sitting on a quarter horse and his little boy was sitting on a horse behind his mother. And the mother was sitting there with her arm around one of the little boys and her other hand was on top of a big dog. And then they had mama donkey and a baby donkey and fighting chickens and ducks and guineas. And it had everything there is in Mexico. And it was a big picture. And but I usually it's got something to do with the horses, or I don't usually paint them. I've painted a lot of portraits, but they're always with horses.
How do you find the unique personality of a particular horse? I mean, these quarter horses, they all obviously are quarter horses, but each one is a unique individual. How do you find that as an artist?
That's real simple. It's just like your kids are all different. And
so when you look at a quarter horse, a photo of a quarter horse, for instance, you can immediately see, well, this one's a little bit different in the jaw than the last one I did or whatever.
That's exactly right. I can just look at a horse and tell where you need to change him to make him where people would like him a little bit better. It's real simple. It's just like these judges, they know what they're looking for. Of course, I couldn't be a judge because I'd eliminate too many horses.
If they weren't the Orren Mixer ideal, they're out of there.
Well, you don't have that perfect horse. You can. I've painted horses that got faults that were the greatest when it comes to performance. And then I've looked at horses that really they're a perfect statue, but a lot of them can't do anything, or they don't have the brains or something. They're just they're like people.
Now, an awful lot of the paintings that you do, maybe all of them, I don't know, are of horses that are no longer living. So you're working from a photograph, right?
No. You've
done it both ways?
Most all the horses I've painted, I observed. And there's one I took to Wyoming. The horse died about a week before I got there. That was Bullet for King Merritt. And they were great ranchers, and the whole family was cowboys. And this horse weighed less than 1,000 pounds, and a lot of your top cowboys rode him. And now that's a great horse to be able to be a top horse and rope steers. He was a steer roping horse.
So would it be your preference then to always have a live subject to paint as opposed to working from a...
I do what people want.
Whatever the boss says, you do.
And of course, that's a good example of why you are always working for somebody, even if you're self-employed, like my guest Orren Mixer. We'll be back with more from him when the horse show continues. Stay with us. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a Travel In Corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pin, 8 panels make an 18-foot round pin. Second reason I'm crazy about Travel In Corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter in, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel In Corrals. Travel, the letter N, corrals.com. Fact of the matter is, nailed on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the five very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com.
Hi, this is Leslie Nielsen, and you're listening to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb.
Thank you, Mr. Nielsen. My guest is Orren Mixer, legendary painter of horses of all types. Caught up with him at the AQHA World Show.
I don't have any paintings at home to sell. I don't have any paintings, period. I've had people to call the Western Horsemen or the Quarter Horse Association, find out where I live, and they'll come there thinking that my studio will be full of pictures. I don't have any pictures. I don't even have anything to show them.
So by that, you mean that everything you do is on commission for somebody. They hire you to do a particular painting. Talk to me about the medium that you're using. Is it oil? Is it acrylic?
It's all oil. It's all oil. I've been oil on linen canvas, and that's what I started out. And of course, I'm in a rut.
It's a good rut to be in.
I paint a certain way, and if I change my style or something, well, people... it wouldn't be Orren Mixer. And so I try to paint just what people have enjoyed all these years.
Now, when you start, do you start with a pencil and you do a little sketch, or how do you do it?
Oh, it all depends. I take a bunch of photographs. I can take a brush and start on a lot of them. And like the one in Mexico City, I had a lot of pencil work on that to get my composition with that much stuff in it. But there's different ways to do these things, and
I know this is going to be a tough question, because it's like saying, which is your favorite child? Do you have any one painting that you've done throughout your life? And if you don't mind me saying, you're 81 years old now, you're still actively painting and building frames and riding bulldozers and all kinds of things. In your whole career, is there any one painting that jumps out?
No, every time I start one, I try to make it exciting or different than the last bunch, whatever I painted. And it's like that last Legend 4. They gave me a list of horses, and then they tell me that some of them, they thought this or that ought to be in there. And I started with those three heads down there in the Legend. That was Legend 1. But nobody knew there's going to be a Legend 2 or a 3 or 4.
Or 5.
Yeah, or 5.
Some of these horses, they have on all of the Legends paintings, they have the dates that the horse lived. Some of them go back to 1960 is when the horse died. So you painted that portrait before the horse died? I'm thinking in particular of Driftwood here. It is 1932 to 1960.
Oh, Driftwood. I never did see Driftwood.
So that would be one you'd have done from a photograph.
They had a lot of photographs they sent me. They were black and white. But I knew Driftwood was a great horse because I painted a lot of rope horses back in the 50s. Steer roping horses and calf roping horses.
Now you've got these composite paintings where they're all in the same painting. Did you do each one of those individually and then somebody put it together in a composite?
No, I did it that way.
So they were all on the same canvas, huh?
Oh, yeah.
So what happened if you did one just great and then the next one wasn't so good? Have you ever had to just paint over it and start over, Orren?
Well, I've started over, but I'll tell you something that is kind of funny. These prints we're looking at, they've been cropped, make them balance real good. Out at the Quarter Association, these four originals are at the Quarter Association. And there's some lady out there one day said, at the top of these, there's more space because on the magazine cover, it said Legend. And this lady said, well, what'd he do? Start at the bottom and didn't have enough, had too much space and quit. But if people would understand that Legend is printed across the top of the magazine. But then when they had prints made, they cropped them down where it makes a nice picture.
All right, Orren, I understand you have a story you would like to tell us.
Well, I don't necessarily like to tell you, but I'm going to tell you.
I'm going to twist your arm here, okay?
Yeah, that'd be all right. That's what happens anyway. But about 4 or 5 years ago, the association had me paint a picture, and I had them to check that thing before we printed it. And they said, well, this is fine. They had a bunch of judges out there that been around the country, and they was there today. Anyway, they couldn't find anything wrong. When they called me back, I said, well, there's bound to be something you want me to change. We'll call you back in about an hour. And they called back in an hour and said, go with it. So they printed this picture and came down to show. I had a little booth I made up here in the front. And I wasn't there 15 minutes. Little old girl came by. She was a brunette. She said, Orren Mixer, how come all those girls are blondes? And I didn't know it. I looked at the painting was there, and I stopped and looked at that painting, and I said, holy cow. And before that show was over, which is 2 weeks, there was a lot of brunettes that hit me up about those three blondes. And it was amazing how many blondes would be standing there, and they just smiled. But I called Bill Brewer and Don Treadwin, and I said, I thought you guys checked that. Well, we was looking at the horses. But anyway, we signed a lot of those prints, and
so I figured you were going to say you were back in the back with a paintbrush making some of them brunettes.
No, but I'll tell you what I did. I finished a painting here last year for another association, and there was four women in it, and I'll guarantee you they all had different colored hair.
You learned your lesson, huh?
I learned my lesson.
I'm going to ask you to tell me one last story here, because I heard you telling somebody else this, and that was about some of the indignities that some of your paintings have suffered over the years, and you're called to sort of repair the damage. Tell me the story about the young boys and the arrow.
Oh, they were just a bunch of good kids. I raised four boys. Every one of them painted on my pictures, but there's one of them used the same color I did, and it took a long time to even notice it. But Punch Jones out at Tatum, New Mexico. He had a nice mare named Maroon and a race mare. And I painted that, and this is a long time ago, 1956, in fact. And, you know, years ago, people go to town on Saturday. Well, I think him and Mama went to town one Saturday, and as soon as they got out of sight, while the kids, you know, they start cutting up. And they had a clock up there by this painting, and they had a bow and arrow. And I don't know if they ever found out what kid did it. You know, when you get four kids, it's hard to find out who did it. But anyway, this kid shot at that clock, and he missed the clock, and it hit that mare, and it went right through her heart.
The painting of the mare, not the real mare.
Painting, went through the painting. He called and said, Orren, I've got a problem. And he said, there's an arrow went through this the heart of this painting of Maroon. And I said, he wanted to know if there's anything we could do. And I took it home and got some linen string and sewed up that hole and fixed it up a little bit and painted over it. And he's got it back on the wall now. I hope they haven't shot any more holes in it.
Well, I think on that note, sir, I'm going to let you go. It has been an absolute pleasure talking to you. I've been an admirer of your work for as long as I've been interested in horses, and I hope that we'll see you again here next year.
All you got to do is just come along and look at these horses. You're looking at the best.
I agree, sir. Thank you.
Still to come on The Horse Show, what is the scientific basis of natural horsemanship? Why does it work? Well, Dr. Jennifer MacLeay will be here to address that very question when The Horse Show continues. Stay right where you are. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a travel-in corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pin. 8 panels make an 18-foot round pin. Second reason I'm crazy about travel-in corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter in, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel In Corrals. Travel, the letter in, corrals.com. Fact of the matter is, nailed-on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the five very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com. If you're like me, you need a pretty good reason to sit in front of a TV set these days. Hi everybody, Rick Lamb here. RFD TV is that reason. Finally, there's a network for people like you and me, people who care about the rural lifestyle, about livestock and tradition. RFD TV brings you family-friendly programming that entertains and educates and never ever offends. Every week you see the icons of country music with Ralph Emery, Crook and Chase, and Marty Stewart. You get some of the top horsemen in the world like Clinton Anderson, Chris Cox, Craig Cameron, and the Pirellis. And you get farm news and special features. Oh yeah, you get me too. So join me and the millions of other RFD TV viewers. Call your satellite or cable provider and ask for RFD TV, rural America's most important network. It's TV we can all be proud of. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com or give them a call at 615-227-9292.
Thank you for listening to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb. If you have a question, request, or comment, we want to hear from you. Our fax number is area code 602-279-0980. Or if you would like to email us, the address is lambemail@aol.com. Now, back to Rick.
Hey, welcome back, everybody. You know, natural horsemanship is a very popular pursuit these days. But it's only been known by that name for about the past 20 years. We know, however, that the principles of natural horsemanship have been with us through the ages. In fact, they go back at least as far as the Greek general Xenophon in 400 BC. A lot of people talk about the techniques of natural horsemanship, but what about the scientific basis for it? Why does it work? There has to be a reason. Well, today we're going to talk about that with Dr. Jennifer MacLeay, author of the book Smart Horse, Training Your Horse with the Science of Natural Horsemanship. Dr. MacLeay, welcome to The Horse Show.
Well, thank you for having me.
I understand that you prefer to be called Jennifer, so we're going to dispense with formality today, and I'm going to call you Jennifer.
That's just fine.
Okay. I want to read you something that caught my eye in your introduction here and then have you comment on it.
Sure.
It says, I will show you that the methods we use to train horses both traditionally and naturally all involve the same principles. Now, if traditional horsemanship and natural horsemanship involve the same principles, why is natural horsemanship so much better?
Basically, what I'm trying to get across is that there are some basic psychological principles involved as far as reward and punishment. And many of the principles used in training horses more traditionally involve some forms of reward, but largely are based on punishment. Whereas natural horsemanship, more importantly, emphasizes the reward aspect.
So it's a little bit of a difference in emphasis, not so much that natural horsemanship never punishes or traditional horsemanship never rewards. It's just kind of where the emphasis falls, it sounds like.
Exactly. There has to be a balance that we want horses to maintain their motivation and continue to be very excited about the work that they're doing without developing fear that may come from inappropriate use of punishment.
You know, one of the things that I think makes natural horsemanship such a valuable thing for people to study is it focuses on the essential nature of the horse as a prey animal and the kinds of things that motivate horses and how that's different from us. I guess it's natural for us. I think they have a word for it.
Anthropomorphism.
Anthropomorphism. I usually have that right on the tip of my tongue. But we tend to have a tendency to indulge in anthropomorphism, and by that, of course, I mean that we assign human traits to non-human animals, as well as sometimes even inanimate things. But I think that happens a lot with horses, and natural horsemanship counters that by pointing out that horses are essentially different. They are prey animals, where we are, in the grand scheme of things, predatory animals. Talk to me a little bit about that kind of basic psychology of the prey animal.
Well, I think we have to realize what we have in common with horses and what we don't have in common with them. And we certainly have in common with them the desire to be motivated to learn. And we are motivated to learn when we get positive reinforcement. And, you know, we are no different from horses in that regard. If we get a question right, or if we solve a problem right, and somebody's right there to say, oh, that was just the best job ever, and to give you a little treat or pat you on the back, then that makes you feel really good about what you're doing and makes you motivated to learn. And horses are no different in that regard. I think what we forget, horses are far more in tune to our body language and far more in tune to their environment in general than we are. And we forget that they can pick up on very subtle body cues that we generally take for granted. And we need to realize how our behavior affects our horse's behavior before we can really be effective trainers.
You know, you tell a story in your book that I thought was so good at illustrating that very point about how our body language is picked up by the horse, and we aren't even aware of what we're doing. And that's the story of Clever Hans. Why don't you tell that story?
Well, I think Clever Hans is an excellent story to emphasize that, in that Clever Hans was a horse that lived in the early part of the 1900s, and many of us have seen horses that have been trained similarly since then, but he was kind of the first. He lived in Germany, and his handler honestly thought that he had taught Clever Hans how to read math problems and answer them by pawing the appropriate number of times as the answer. So that if he wrote 1 plus 1 on a chalkboard, then Clever Hans would paw twice. And a number of academic professionals got together to study Clever Hans, and what they found out was that Clever Hans would only get the question right when the handler knew the answer and when he could see the handler. And even though they were instructing the handler never to move, what they found was that all the handler had to do was lower his eyebrows and Hans would start to paw, and when he raised his eyebrows, Hans would stop pawing. I mean, just pretend like you were concentrating on something very hard. Think about what your face does. It's very natural for us to kind of lower our eyebrows and kind of squinch our eyes and think really hard. And then if we're watching something and we're getting excited about the fact that they're getting closer and closer to the right answer, it's very natural for us to open our eyes really wide and raise our eyebrows. And that was just that small cue was enough to get Hans to start and stop pawing.
The irony is that the handler wasn't even aware that he was doing this.
Exactly.
He genuinely thought that Hans was figuring this all out on his own.
Exactly.
Which underscores the point that we're making here, is that the body cues that we give off, the communication that occurs going from us to the horse, we are not even aware of half the time. So that's why, and I think this is embodied in the study of natural horsemanship, is becoming more aware of what signals you are putting off with your body language, your position, your attitude, even what is going on in your mind, because that does manifest itself physically in ways that we just aren't always aware of.
Exactly, and I think that's what makes, you know, John Lines and Pat Pirelli, Buck Brannaman, all of those guys, you know, too many that I could possibly name, so good at what they do, in that they are very consistent in what they do. And they've learned through trial and error, and perhaps they are aware or maybe they aren't aware of how their body language communicates to their horses.
You know, one thing that John Lyons told me one time, I was asking him how a horse could tell the difference between a cue given for one purpose and given for another purpose, if the cues were essentially the same physically. And he says, because you're thinking differently. That's a very important point. What's going on in your mind will determine how your horse interprets a given physical cue.
Right. And even though to humans, we think that the cue is the same. In reality, how we apply it is not the same.
Right, right.
And horses can pick up on those subtleties. It's what makes them so adaptable in their environments. If horses didn't learn quickly, and if horses didn't remember things very well, they would never survive out in the wild. They need to remember year after year where the best watering holes are, where the best grazing is, where the predators tend to hunt them. And if they didn't have those that ability to really take in their environment and remember it, they would never survive.
You bet. Let's talk about what you call the four stages of learning, and these, I guess, are fairly widely accepted in the study of learning. I'll kind of throw each one of them out, and you can maybe comment on each one of them.
Sure.
First one is acquisition. What does that mean?
Acquisition is the very first stage of learning, and it's when we first start applying a new or a novel cue, and we're trying to have the horse start to understand what the appropriate response is to that cue, and then we reinforce that response usually with a treat or a pat or a rub or something like that. Acquisition is the stage where they may only get the question right or the appropriate response right, maybe 1 out of 10 times, 1 out of 20 times, something like that. But as they start to understand more clearly, then they're going to get the question right or respond to that cue appropriately, more correctly, more and more often.
Now, as they start doing this with some regularity and some predictability, you pass into, I guess, the second stage, which you call fluency.
Exactly. And fluency is exactly what it says, is that when we ask for that cue, then they reply with the appropriate behavior almost all of the time.
Mm-hmm. You know, and I think this is a good time to point out an essential, I think, quality of a good trainer or a good horse handler, and that is patience, because getting from this acquisition stage into this fluency stage where the horse repeatedly and predictably does, you know, responds to the cue as you would like him to, it takes a while.
Oh, it does. And you are absolutely right, because patience not only plays a role as we go from acquisition into fluency, but it really plays a role when we go into generalization, which is the third step. You know, horses can learn new concepts fairly quickly. We've all seen, you know, round pen demonstrations where we can teach a horse to accept inside turns and outside turns in a round pen and accept being bridled and saddled for the first time very, very quickly. But the third stage is generalization. That's to say we can take that horse out of that day, that situation, and put them in the middle of a horse show with all that activity around them, and they will consistently perform those behaviors again. And when I do my seminars, and I often talk to owners about this, it's that frustration of, oh, he performs so well at home. How come when I go to the show, it all falls apart? And that's because, it's just another stage of learning. Our horses have to learn that thing, even though the environment is different, they still need to respond to our cues the same way. And if we accept that and know that it's just another stage of learning, then we don't have to be so frustrated.
And of course, how you get from fluency to generalization is you start introducing as much variety into the controlled setting that you started with as possible. You know, if you want to, mm-hmm. if you're working in an arena and you're trying to get a horse prepared for the distractions of being at a show, you start doing things like playing loud music and having, you know, cars go by and you know, loud noises and various things that the horse can get accustomed to hearing and learning that it's not going to hurt him and that you're there to reassure him and so forth. And then when you do go out, it's not such a huge step.
You're absolutely right.
The Horse Show will continue in just a moment with more from Dr. Jennifer MacLeay on the scientific basis of natural horsemanship. We'll find out about positive rewards and negative rewards. Now, how can that be? Stay tuned and find out.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is a copyrighted production of Lamb Chop Studios, Phoenix, Arizona. Unauthorized use is strictly prohibited.
That's music to my ears. Hi, I'm Pat Pirelli.
And I'm Linda Pirelli. If you love everything about horses, the way they look, the way they sound, even the way they smell, well, you're among friends at RFD-TV.
RFD-TV has the most horse programs of any network on television, every day, all year long.
take Pirelli Natural Horsemanship, for example. Each week, you'll learn how you and your horse can become recreation for each other, how training can be shaped to the personality or horsenality of your horse,
and how you can reach your horsemanship goals.
RFD-TV brings you family-friendly programming that educates, entertains, and inspires. It's TV we can all be proud of.
And it's available on satellite and cable systems throughout the country. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com.
Or call 615-227-9292.
RFD-TV and Pirelli Natural Horsemanship.
We're teaming up to make life better for you and your horse.
Imagine this. Your stirrup drops 3 inches with the push of a button and locks back in place with the lift of your toe. That, my friends, is the legendary Easy Up Stirrup Extender, and it makes a huge difference in mounting your horse. Learn all about it at easyupstirrup.com. And while you're there, check out the Easy Up Stirrup Swivel. It takes the stress off your knees while riding. Easy Up Stirrup Extenders and Stirrup Swivels are available for English and Western saddles, and you can order them online at easyupstirrup.com. Come on, get out and ride again.
For 128 years, ADM Alliance Nutrition has been doing what's right for the horse. It was ADM who cut back on starch and sugar, ADM who balanced vitamins and minerals, and ADM who put forage first in horse nutrition.
Today, you can still trust ADM for the information and products you need.
Learn more about equine nutrition and ADM's premium products at growstrong.com. That's growstrong.com. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse.
Make watering your horses automatic and absolutely safe with the Bar A horse drinker. It's non-electric, and the bowl empties after every drink. That keeps the water warmer in winter and cooler in summer. Plus, you avoid breeding mosquitoes or algae. Right now, save 10% on the Bar A horse drinker when you mention Rick Lamb. 10%. Call 800-451-2230 or visit horsedrinker.com. The Bar A horse drinker. 800-451-2230 or horsedrinker.com.
EPM is a devastating neurologic disease that can strike anytime, anywhere. Be prepared with Protozil, the only FDA-approved top-dress EPM treatment. These alfalfa-based pellets are proven to rapidly reach therapeutic levels and are a less stressful option for you and your horse than a paste. For a limited time only, Merck Animal Health is offering a $50 Protozil rebate with proof of purchase from your veterinarian. To download the rebate, visit Protozil.com. That's Protazil.com. See website for complete product safety information.
The wait is over. You can now get the audio version of Human to Horseman. 5 hours on 4 standard audio CDs, just $24.95. Visit thehorseshow.com to order.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is here every week at this time. So tell a friend.
That's right, folks. Tell everyone you know that The Horse Show is on the air and on the internet at thehorseshow.com. My guest is Dr. Jennifer MacLeay, author of Smart Horse, Training Your Horse with the Science of Natural Horsemanship. There's something kind of calming and healing almost for us to go out and work with a horse and not have it be quite that simple. Have it take a little bit longer. It's a little more satisfying when you do get there. And I think that in itself is kind of a surprise benefit of working with horses.
Oh, definitely. And that ties in really nicely to the fourth stage, which is maintenance, where our horse performs and we have that real connection with them, and they perform off of very subtle cues in all different environments, whether it's the trail or the horse show or at home, and we have, you know, that bomb-proof horse that we've always wanted.
Let's talk a little bit about the nature of reward and punishment. We mentioned kind of as the premise here when we started out that it's not that natural horsemanship never uses punishment. It's just that the emphasis is more on the positive side of things. Talk to me about how the types of things that we would use for rewards, the types of things that we would use for punishments.
Well, it isn't that punishment is wrong. It's just that to use punishment effectively in training, it has to be used in very exact circumstances, and it has to be employed in really a very exact and perfect way, because if you don't, it can create fear and sensitization in the horse to various stimuli and situations, and so it's really very counterproductive. And so I don't say that punishment in and of itself is bad. It has to be employed in very particular situations, and it has to be employed correctly. Otherwise, we're going to end up in a lot more trouble than where we started. And that's why using positive rewards works so well, because it's much more forgiving and it's much more motivating. And we talk about two different kinds of ways of rewarding horses. And the first is what we call a positive reward, and that's very simple. That's the patting, the rubbing, giving them a little treat. If they've been running around the pen, allowing them time to come stand with us, bond with us, and have time to rest. Those are all positive rewards. The other form of a reward is called a negative reward, and natural horsemanship uses negative rewards very consistently. And they also work extremely well in teaching the horse that their previous behavior was the correct behavior, but they don't do quite as much for motivation as giving them a little pat or a treat.
Now let's talk about negative reward. I understand that to be the removal of something that was sort of unpleasant, almost like the removal of pressure, for instance. Is that what you mean by negative?
That's exactly what I mean. And we use the term pressure a lot in natural horsemanship to mean either we're in the horse's physical space, or we're actually pushing on them, or we're swinging the rope behind them and driving them forward. And when we remove that pressure, we stop swinging the rope. We stop pressing on them from the ground, or simply we stop pushing them with our seat when we're riding. We stop pulling on a rein. We stop kicking with our legs. Whenever we stop any of those things, it's a sign to the horse that whatever they're doing is the correct thing. It in itself is a form of reward.
And, of course, the idea there is it's going to be more likely to happen again.
Exactly.
Under similar circumstances. That's part of the learning curve. Let's talk about the other side of things. Now, we do occasionally need to introduce some sort of quote-unquote punishment, and I know a lot of people cringe at that word, but let's kind of explore that a little bit.
Sure. I think it's really important to realize that punishment is most appropriate in situations where we have a horse that is acting aggressive towards us, where we have a dominance problem, where the horse is constantly asserting their dominance over their handler. It is completely inappropriate to use punishment in a situation where the horse is already fearful. If we have a horse that's reacting out of fear and we punish them for being fearful, often all we'll really do is reinforce that fear, and the next time they're in that situation, they're going to be more scared than they were in the first place. And there are two different forms of punishment that we talk about. There is, you know, the positive punishment where we're, again, doing something to the horse. We're hitting them, we're chasing them aggressively and causing them to run away, but most often we're talking about hitting them. But there is another more subtle form of punishment, and that is how horses punish each other, or more basically how horses establish dominance over each other. And that's what's called a simple displacement. If you watch horses out in the pasture, how one will establish dominance over another is they will go and move them out of their space. If the subordinate horse is drinking water or eating out of a pan, then the dominant horse will come over and kick him out of that pan or kick him away from the water, and that's called a displacement. And we do that through many natural horsemanship techniques where we're teaching them to move out of our space.
Now, there is a relationship with time in here that I want to explore briefly. You mentioned John Lyons earlier. He talks about the 3-second rule. And however you quantify it, there is a fixed amount of time or a limited amount of time during which the horse can associate his action with your reaction. In other words, if the horse took a bite at you, as John Lyons would say, you know, you have to respond within 3 seconds, or he doesn't get that your response was for that.
Exactly. That's exactly right.
Is the same time limitation on the positive reinforcement side, too? Do you have to reinforce quickly in order to make that effective?
Definitely, definitely. And that is a lot of the basis between this clicker training, where people are talking about using a sound as a way of rewarding an animal. And they use this in dogs, and they use this in dolphin training, because it allows you to apply the sound at the very instant that the animal performs the correct behavior. Because, again, the closer that association, the better. I've gotten out of the habit of using a clicker. I used to practice with my horses using clicker trainers, but I found between using my rope and using my clicker and having, I usually carry some treats with me too, I just didn't have enough hands to train my horses. And so I actually just trained my horses to really understand the word good as a reinforcer in and of itself. And so now I have a verbal way of reinforcing my horses and rewarding them in addition to all the other tools in my arsenal.
One of the things that I've always found about natural horsemanship is it's a very positive sort of a thing. It instills hope that you can have the kind of relationship you've always dreamed of with your horse. Natural horsemanship is something that's accessible to everybody.
Oh, I agree, and it is very, very inspiring. And I hope that my book, the whole idea there is just to give people some more understanding. I had become initially frustrated when I started studying natural horsemanship in saying, and you know, well, why is this trainer doing this and this other trainer doing something else? And they're both calling it natural horsemanship, and they both seem to work, and how can that be? And so I think by understanding how these principles work, you could say, well, yeah, they're both applying the same principles, they're just doing it in a different way.
Right. And I firmly believe every single trainer that I've talked to certainly has had something positive to contribute. And it's not that you have to go out and completely embrace one person's way of doing things. The more you have a general understanding, a background, and this book is a great way to get it, you'll be able to kind of pick and choose the things that work for you out of what everybody else is doing. The name of the book, folks, is Smart Horse, Training Your Horse with the Science of Natural Horsemanship. The author is Dr. Jennifer MacLeay, and that is spelled, by the way, MacLeay. She's an assistant professor at Colorado State University, one of the great equine schools in this country. And you're obviously a very talented communicator. I could tell you were a teacher. The way you explain things is just wonderful.
Oh, so. Thank you.
And there you have it, my friends. Thanks again to Dr. Jennifer MacLeay, assistant professor at Colorado State University, for her talking about her book, Smart Horse, Training Your Horse with the Science of Natural Horsemanship. And I hope you enjoyed our tribute to the late Orren Mixer. It was one of those moments in my life that was really special when I met somebody I just sort of idolized and found him to be so accessible and really enjoyed talking to him. And I know everybody felt that way about Mr. Orren Mixer. Again, I talked to him in 2001. He passed away in 2008. And his work will live on forever. I'm absolutely certain of that. I want to remind you about my website, thehorseshow.com or ricklamb.com. New and improved, we rebuilt it from the ground up. It's all built now around our media. You can watch our TV shows, radio shows. They're all streamed through YouTube, so that means that they're accessible from any device. I'm not talking about just your laptop computer or your desktop computer or your tablet or your phone. Any of those devices can now get The Horse Show, radio or television. So check it out, ricklamb.com or thehorseshow.com. While you're there, check out my blog. I've always got something, I hope, interesting to say. Have fun, ride safely, and I'll see you next time. For The Horse Show, I'm Rick Lamb.